15 minutes ago, this northern saw-whet owl was leading a perfectly normal life. Then this happened. Saw-whet owls are the tiniest owls in eastern North America. They're wicked cute. And most of all, they migrate predictably, which means in about an hour, we should be able to catch a few. This is our banding headquarters. Don't try to find this place. It's off limits, behind two lock gates and a half dozen private property no trespassing signs. All I'll say is it's somewhere in down east Maine. Sun's almost down. Let's take a look at where we're going to be working tonight. There are two sets of nets. These are set up to catch boreal and long-eared owls. Now let's take a look at those that are prepped to catch northern saw-whet owls. You'll notice that all these nets are furled up so that we don't accidentally catch anything during the day.
Owls can see in the dark, but I can't. Would you mind? Ooh, thanks. There are five of us here. Connor, Liv, Aaron, Glenn, and me, Bob Duchesne. My job is easy. Stay out of the way. Don't break anything. Let's go drop the nets.
Pulled the screw right out of the end of it, I think.
I'm untied, or?
No, I think it pulled the pulley right out.
Here's the way it works. Owl calls are played on loudspeakers, and passing owls may come down to investigate. Why does that work? Maybe it triggers some kind of territorial response in the owls. Or maybe they hear one owl hooting down there. They think if it's safe for that one, it must be safe for me. Why this spot? Well, imagine you're an owl coming down from Maritime Canada. You don't want to fly over the ocean. You're a terrible flyer. You follow the coastline down, and it funnels right past this spot. You're kind of squeezed through this corridor, and we're right here waiting for you. There are other tagging stations and other good corridors across the country because this is valuable information. We'll go over that when we get inside with this owl. Right now, we're following the first rule of owl banding.
How are we doing?
Don't hurt the owl.
It was funny. I'm just sitting there, and I heard a little squeak. I thought it was a porcupine. And then I kind of like look around for a second, and I look over to my right, and I saw this little dude just fly right in.
They can get quite tangled up in the net, but it's mid-October and the crew has now banded a lot of owls. They're getting good at it.
Yeah, you're not so bad, huh? You're not going anywhere.
What do they call that, the popsicle grip?
Ice cream cone grip? Kind of. I'm doing like a photographer's grip.
Yeah.
This would be the popsicle grip.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Kind of got his wings bundled up. And that's the more appropriate way to kind of handle them. I've got the feet and wings controlled at the same time.
Right.
The next step is getting them in the bag. They tend to calm down when they're not being handled and they can't see a threat. This works on most songbirds. I wouldn't try it with a badger. The biggest threat to owl safety is right overhead somewhere. A few minutes ago, Liv spotted a barred owl watching. Larger owls can also hear this hooting from the loudspeakers, and they know a tasty meal when they hear one. So sometimes barred owls and great horned owls will come in looking for a hasty meal. Liv noticed this one on the very first owl. There are several ways to deal with predators, but the best way is to stand guard and discourage the barred owl from getting any closer. For the next hour, Liv is going to hide, wait, and watch. Everyone gets a turn as the night wears on. We've got two other problems. The wind is from the southwest, and it's still pretty strong tonight. That's a headwind, and these owls don't really like to fly against it. And then, it's a full moon. Saw-whet owls need to feel invisible. They don't like to be out in a bright moonlight, or predators will see them. So, spoiler alert, we're not going to get 20 owls tonight. We'll be lucky if we get just a handful. But that's still cool. We're going in the trailer, but you should still hear the owl calls outside. The northern saw-whet owl is supposed to sound like a saw being sharpened on a whetstone. The long-eared owl is just individual hoots. And the boreal owl is the thing that sounds like a Wilson snipe flying around, but louder, steadier, and not moving.
Now it's biting me. Let's hear the
bill is better than the feet. The feet are what hurt.
Here's the magic. Northern saw-whet owls have a huge breeding range, but they're shy. They're nocturnal. They're deep in the woods. They're not very well studied, not over the years anyway, until now. Imagine how time-consuming and expensive it would be to go into the woods, find one owl family, and track it for a season. Ooh. But instead of going to them, what if they came to you? If hundreds of owls came to you, you'd have a huge sample size. You could assess the health of the population. You could assess the health of the forest. You could see if there's any changes in migration. Turns out a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush because they give off a lot of clues. Male or female? How old? How healthy? We've got three birds to work with tonight, and each bander gets a turn at it. The first rule is don't hurt the owl. The second rule is don't hurt the biologist. These little guys are generally pretty calm, but when agitated, they snap their bills as a warning. They will bite, but it's their sharp talons that will cause the pain. The first step is to weigh the bird, and it can't be done in the bag because the bird will wiggle and throw off the scale. Turns out they fit perfectly and harmlessly into a juice can. In less than a minute, this bird is both weighed and banded. Like most raptors, the female is bigger than the male, so the weight actually helps reveal the gender. A full-grown adult female saw-whet owl weighs about the same as a medium tomato, or four pickleballs. Work with me here. Wings are a dead giveaway to the age of the bird. Owls don't molt their feathers all at once. Different age birds molt differently. If all the feathers are new, it was hatched this year. Otherwise, you can see which of the wing feathers are new and shiny and which are dark and worn.
73 for the tail.
You can tell how well nourished the bird is by blowing down out of the way and looking at the subcutaneous fat. The more fat, the better fed.
That's a one.
Eye color also reveals a nutritional clue. The darker the yellow, the more likely the bird is hunted well, more protein. No surprise, older, more experienced birds tend to have darker eyes. Another clue, bird feathers have pigments. Melanin is the dark pigment that adds stiffness and strength to a wing feather. Carotene provides most of the reds, orange, yellows that you find in birds. Owls and a few other nocturnal birds have a third pigment, porphyrin. Under an ultraviolet light, it glows pink. But as the feathers wear, the pigment wears out and there's less pink. This is a hatch year bird, but the pink has faded enough that it probably hatched early in the spring.
I think they're all new, right? I think it's very worn down.
That looks like a hatch year to me.
Okay.
Sure, it may be uncomfortable for the bird for a few minutes, but it's for their own good. It's like a colonoscopy. The more we know about the health of the forest and the health of the owls, the better. We'd need to know if populations are growing, shrinking, or holding steady. Is climate change screwing up the timing of migration? How's this bird doing? He can keep his bobblehead steady as he's being moved around, which shows good reflexes and balance, and he is ready for release. After being under the bright lights, it takes a little while for the owl to reorient itself and get its night vision back. In order to release it, you just perch it on your hand or perch it on your shoulder and wait. When it's ready to fly, it will. And if necessary, you can encourage it a little bit. We check the nets every half hour. This could go all night. You look tired. You should get some sleep right after you hit that subscribe button. Owl will be back.